this is Aggressor from Aura Noir. You are listening to The Bloodshed with the Vampire on Metal Messiah Radio International.
Hi, Aggressor. It's a great honor to have you here on The Bloodshed with the Vampire on Metal Messiah Radio.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're always welcome. This is your home.
Oh, cool, cool. A home in the frequencies, then.
Aura Noir, a band geared towards thrash connoisseurs with active mind and mean spirit. The band stands at the forge of metal definitive genre in an age where the underground is utterly besotted with bands. These Norwegian thrash stalwarts don't so much tread the line between savagery and sophistication as stomped upon it, showering dirt in the face of lesser act with each smoldering creator of an album. Formed in Oslo, Norway in 1993, Aura Noir are an extremely fucking good black and thrash metal band, comprised of three talented individuals that have shown their quality in various other projects like Satyricon, Immortal, Virus, Ulver, So Lamented, Mayhem, Nader Sadek, Ava Inferi. The lineup consists of Aggressor, you as the bassist and vocalist, Apollyon, a drummer, and backup vocals, Blasphemer as the guitarist. Aggressor, how did you start the band way back in 1993, and how did you met with Apollyon and Blasphemer?
Well, I started it as a solo project, actually, just recording stuff by myself. And stylistically, it was all over the place. Didn't have a proper direction, really. And I met Apollyon in, I think that was 94. We were just hanging around in the same place in Oslo, and we were just around each other, and we gradually got to know each other, and then I asked him to join me. And I don't know, more or less instinctively, I guess we just found this direction with a mix of thrash metal and black metal, and we just stuck to that, and we haven't looked back since, really.
How did you meet with Blasphemer?
Blasphemer, we met him on Elm Street in late 95, early 96, I guess. And since we didn't have a guitar player, we asked him to join us. And he was just starting out in Mayhem at the time. Yeah, we just clicked. He's the same breed as us. And we just thought it's going to be good to stick with him. He knows how to play the guitar. He's good input.
How did you felt and are still feeling the band is responding, working with well-experienced musicians whom were or are parts of different well-known bands instead of working with unknown musicians?
I don't know. When we started up in the 90s, we were all kind of, we didn't have too much experience, any one of us. So I think we've gained a lot of experience, each on our own with our different projects and bands. And together, we've developed this sound and we've developed this way of playing together. We know each other very well. We enjoy playing together, and out of that, the music can grow, you know?
You guys were inspired by bands like Slayer, Creeiter, Sodom, Destruction, Dark Angel, Sadus, Autopsy, Celtic Frost, Battery, Dark Throne, Venom, and Motorhead, to say some. Are these bands responsible you decided to become a metal musician and to form a band and to follow their music style, even through? We all know Aura Noir have their own Norwegian black thrash metal style.
Yeah, definitely. If it wasn't for these bands, I don't think we'd exist. At least we wouldn't sound like we do. It's the very, very important music, you know, all the stuff that you discovered when you started discovering music on your own and started seeking out music independently. If this wasn't forced upon you, you automatically was seeking out extreme music when you were young. And this way, this music sort of becomes a part of your bloodstream. And of course, I'm speaking for myself and also the others, we've been in, all of us has been in more experimental bands and stuff like that. But at the core, we have the same musical upbringing with early Slayer and Exodus and even Metallica and Motörhead and stuff like that.
Did you have a bigger brother or somebody at home that pushed you into music?
I had my folks back home pushed me onto music very early. But I didn't experience metal until the first experience I had with metal. I saw Motörhead Overkill on Swedish television at a friend's place. And I was just totally blown away by it. I must have been maybe 10 years old. And it took me a couple of years until I bought my first Motörhead record, which was On Parole. Yeah. That was kind of crazy. I remember it was Overkill song, was a promotional video they did for that one. So I got into it very early, but it took me quite a while to be able to seek it out and find the music, you know.
Do you still remember your first instrument?
Yes, my first instrument was just an acoustic guitar I had access to.
You still have it?
No, it got broken, but I have a similar one, so...
Do you remember the brand?
I think it was Suzuki or something like that. Yeah, actually. Yeah.
Okay, talking about...
Not a moped, it was a guitar.
Talking about the band gaining experience through so many years being on the road in the studio. I guess now Aura Noir is a band to be the prime example of riding the line between black and thrash metal in a way that has inspired many bands since your debut full-length Black Thrash Attack in 96. How do you feel about Aura Noir being the inspiration behind a younger generation of black and thrash metal musicians?
Of course, that's an honor. I've never thought of it as people say that we coined the phrase black thrash metal and all this kind of stuff. But to me, it's this is the natural extreme metal that I want to play naturally. It's not ever something that we've tried to build or something like that, like a brand or anything like that. It just feels very natural for us to play this kind of music, and we've never really called it anything but maybe thrash or ourselves. Other people have called it black thrash. This was unfamiliar to me in the 90s at least.
But I still want to congratulate you, Aggressor, because being the inspiration for all these younger bands, it must feel very good.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely, it does. Of course, putting them in the right direction, putting young people and making them aware of all the stuff in the 80s is also, it's like a good mission. Mission for us to point in the right direction.
If we go over the band discography, there was different EPs, split and compilation released throughout the years, while their full-length discography was as follows: 96, Black Thrash Attack. I still remember and enjoy music, songs like The Best, On One Who Smite, Eternity, Your Shadow, Fighting for Hell. This album was released via a German malicious record. Then we go over to 1998, where Deep Tracks of Hell was released through the Dutch Hammer Heart Records. I still remember these tracks like Deep Track of Hell, Purifications of Hell, The Spiral Scar, To Wear the Mark. These great tunes I enjoying so far. And then the band had like a hiatus up to 2004. Then the band came up with the full length again, The Merciless, with great song on like Condor, Hell's Fire, Funeral Thrash, Sordid, released via the Norwegian Tyrant Syndicate. Then 2008, Hates Rides, Gaping a Grave Awaits, Unleash the Demon, Pestilence Scream, Death Mask, Iron Knight, Torment Stormed, Stalker, all these great songs on this great release that you released via the British Peaceful Records. And the last one, 2012, How to Die, with great tunes like Trenches, Fed the Flames, Abaddon, Priest, Hellish Fiend, that was released via the Norwegian's indie recording. I must say, don't misunderstand me, these are all great releases, for sure, each of their own style at some point of time of the band's career. Aggressor, I must ask you, of all of these great releases, which album you love the most and why?
To me personally, I think it's Hades Rise, because it's an album, for the first time we had access to our own studio, our very own studio back then. Apollyon used to live in the up in the northeast mountains, and he had a cellar and a big house where we had this studio, and we had unlimited amount of time to record, and we could just work with the album until it felt right. There was no external studio with a studio engineer that was watching his wristwatch, and the pounds were just going out the window. It was a very pleasurable thing to work with the album and just work with it until it was right.
After being on the road for so long, what are the funniest moments you spend with the bands or with the fans? Do you still remember Aggressor?
It's always a difficult question to answer because these stories, they happen so regularly. Being on tour is a bit monotonous. It's kind of the same thing that's going on over and over again. And you're traveling, then you're on stage, and then you don't remember one day from the other day.
But you guys always sober or...?
No, not really. You know, you're surrounded by drinks all the time, so it's easy to go on a bender. But I remember in the old days when both Apollyon and me were playing drums, we were splitting the set in the middle. So I was playing bass and doing vocals on the first half of the set, and then we were switching. So I was gonna be behind the drum kit, and Apollyon was in the front. And during this switch, which took about like 1.5-2 minutes, we had to entertain the audience somehow. So we just made Blasphemer play a guitar solo, and he hated it. He hated it totally, and he was just on his own on stage while me and Apollyon were messing around with the drum kit. And so that's kind of funny. But nowadays, of course, Apollyon is constantly playing drums, so we don't have to do it anymore.
You still remember which show was that?
Oh, this was pre-2005. So every show we did from 96 or 95 to 2005, we switched like that.
Was it in Norway or somewhere else?
It was all over the place. We played in, we played tours, we played in Norway, Denmark, Greece. We were all over the place doing this kind of thing. We're probably the only extreme metal band ever to do that.
Okay, talking about tours, following multiple tours and festival appearances throughout Europe and America, Aura Noir let loose their far from forgettable fifth album, Out to Die, in 2012. The band inductory release for indie recording, Out to Die, was the first album since Black Thrash Attack to be written as a trio. Look over the shoulder, Aggressor, 6 years back. What did the last album, Out to Die, meant for the band? How has it been worked together as a trio? And what were your experience with this great label, Indie Recordings?
Well, it's been good being on Indie. It's always good to be on a label that's from your own country. And also with Out to Die, I think it was actually a little bit rushed in the end. We had some time schedules that we needed to follow up. It was a bit rushed, actually. So we weren't 100% happy with the results. Anyway, looking back at it, we have some very strong songs on there, and it's very enjoyable to play them live.
Yeah, sure. I enjoyed the album so much, as I just mentioned. The songs that are on this album, after waiting 4 years to hear back from the band, I believe that fans was really enjoying this album very much. Yeah,
we had very good feedback on it, absolutely. And we toured a lot on the album. We did many tours and festivals on a long period afterwards, so it must have been good.
Talking about tours again, I remember Aura Noir toured South America and North America last year. How was the band experience being in America again? And how was the shows gone? And not to even ask, did the fans enjoy to the max, I guess, to all the tunes played by the bands?
Yes, we did only North America last year. However, we did South America in 2016. But yeah, the tour was very good, especially Canada. Montreal stands out as probably one of the best we ever did. Best gigs, but the audience was just insane.
That's your first trip to Canada, Aggressor?
No, it's the second one. But,
the second one. Okay.
Yeah, it was our first independent gigs in Canada. But yeah, we did. The tour was really good. Of course, when we come back, we're coming back with a new album and be on a tour bus, not in a van.
A metal thrash, Aura Noir, finally unleashed their anticipating and long-awaited sixth new album titled Aura Noir after 6 year gap and follow-up to their last album, Out to Die, of 2012. and you can expect some of their finest and rawest material today. Aura Noir, I must say, with an E. I think always when I read the reviews, there's some kind of, what can I say, some kind of questions about the E that's missing behind the name Noir. What's, tell me about this, Aggressor. What's the whole thing about the E, with or without on the Noir?
Yeah, the French were pointing out very early on that our band name is spelled incorrectly and that there should be an E at the end. But we've always seen it as more of international band name than a French one, really, because everybody knows what Aura means. Everybody knows what Noir means. So it's, to us, it's been an international name, but we thought it would be a good idea to release a self-titled album this time, and at the same time, we could spell it correctly to appease the French.
Going back on the Aura Noir tracking list, we will kindly ask you, please, if you don't mind, to present us the 9 track on this album, please.
The first track, Dark Lung of the Storm, I think it's one of our favorites. It's, we wrote it in Bucharest, actually, because we live very far away from each other. Mm-hmm. Blasphemer lives in Portugal, I live in Oslo, Apollyon lives not too far away from me, but anyway, we found it to be very practical to just meet up for 1 week and only concentrate on writing new material. So we wrote it in Bucharest.
Okay.
Yeah. And Grave Dweller is written in Oslo. We called it Creeiter song because the first riff has a very distinctly early Creeiter sounding riff on it. And this was written in Oslo by Apollyon and myself. Hell's Lost Chambers, The Obscuration, Demoniac Flow, Shades Ablaze, Mordant Wind, Coldbone Grasp, and then we have the outro in the end.
With Aura Noir, a title which quite distinctly resembled the band name. Aura Noir turns through some of the most refreshing yet nostalgic track of thrash metal ever to be heard. The album opens with probably one of the most retrospective of riffs, but suddenly somersault you into gloriously dissonant and immersive Aura Noir atmosphere. The soaring and burning shout of Aggressor intensely glows the otherwise quiet variety of and playful guitar riffs and drums together, culminating in the essence of thrash that is well known by Aura Noir. Aggressor, what was the recording and the writing process like have been?
Well, it's important to us to work with the material until it feels right. We take, of course, practical reasons for it to take all this time, but also it's important to not exaggerate anything or to force anything at all. It's important that it's natural, and sometimes it takes a lot of time.
For all the fans to know how you guys work, are you full responsible for the songwriting, and where have you guys recorded the album?
We recorded it a little bit all over the place. Recorded the drums in Norway, about an hour away from Oslo, and the guitars are recorded in Portugal, in Lisbon, and the bass I recorded here at home in Oslo. The vocals are done in Apollyon's home studio, just an hour away from where I live, and we mixed it also there, and it's mastered in Texas.
Okay, this is the first time you have done the recording mixing master at this studio?
So I said we mixed in Apollyon studio, and we mastered in a studio, mastering studio in Texas.
Okay.
So we sent all the files to Texas, and he mastered it for us.
Okay, that's completely different how you did the last album?
Yeah, we've done virtually all our albums, except Hades Rise, we mastered in a specific mastering studio in Oslo that we've used over and over again, and we thought we wanted to try something new this time, so we're very happy with the results, so it's good. We'll be right back.
Vengeful flare of death, frenzied demonic
going back now, Dark Lawn of the Storm is the opener on the album, but not only is the first song on the album track list, but is the promotional, the first promotional single as well. My question is, a very great song. Would you like to talk a little bit on this particular song, Dark Lawn of the Storm, and are you guys planning to release a video clip for the song?
No, if we were to release a video clip, it would be on this song. For some reason, I think it sounds a bit like a comeback with the first sequence of riffs. It sounds very much like a band that's coming back from a hiatus or like a break. But we're very pleased with the song. Very intense piece. And we enjoy playing it live as well. It's a rewarding song to play.
After working with different labels in the past, like we mentioned before, Malicious Record, Hammerheart Records, Tyrant Syndicate, and Peaceville Record, how is the band's second experience with indie records so far? Just a couple days after the self-titled album Aura Noir had been released.
It's been very good. They see us as we are now. They realize that this is a very good record and think that they're gonna do what they can to promote it as best as possible, and it's a good label to be on these days.
What else will the band earn this time compared to the 2012 release?
You know, nobody really makes any money on record sales anymore. It's the only way to make any money these days is to be out on the road and play gigs and sell merch. So what I expect from indie is that they're able to spread our music as far and wide as possible and to promote us as well as possible. It's really not my area of expertise. The music business is not for me at all. So I'm just getting the right vibes from the label this time. They seem to know what kind of band they're dealing with more than on the first record released with them. They were more or less unfamiliar with us. So it's a step up.
Yeah, I guess as long as you are happy and they are happy too with the album sales, they are happy with how the band perform, and you are happy with their work, with their the way they promote and the way they distribute your album throughout the world, you must be satisfied.
Yeah, that's very important to that the record label likes your album and sees the band properly. It's very frustrating to be on a label where they don't realize what kind of band they have and then they don't follow through properly. But this time it seems that they are doing that. They're doing their job properly. That's very good.
The band has been on the road already promoting the new album. Last March 2nd, the band played at the Netherlands Death Fest. That was at 013 in Tilburg, Holland. And on March 31st, the band played in Munich for the Germany at Dark Eastern Metal Meeting. How was those trip gone for the band, and did the fans enjoy the songs of the new album?
The Netherlands Death Fest went well. I think we should have had our own sound guy or something like that, and our own light guy. There were some problems on stage and stuff, but generally the feedback was good. Dark Easter Metal Meeting was because of some circumstances. We had to employ a session drummer because Apollyon was unable to join us for that one. But it was good. We played with him a lot before, so he knows the songs very well. And anyway, we played in the middle of the night, very late, after 12 o'clock, so the audience was dead drunk anyway, so
But this replacement drummer, he already practiced the new songs?
Yeah, we had the time to do a few practice sessions, so it was good. And after Out to Die came out, he was with us for maybe 70 gigs or something like that on a couple of tours, and we were a four-piece for some time after Out to Die.
And who is this replacement drummer, if you don't mind to tell us?
It's Christian Valbo from Obliteration.
Okay, great. The band also played last Friday, April 27th, in Stockholm, Sweden, at the Stockholm Slaughter, the Second Coming, with a great lineup like Marduk, Sepik Flash, Demonical, Entombed ED, Tuck, Struder, Sinister, and many more. How has this year's festival gone? And was this the album release party show?
Yeah, you could say that. It was on the day of the release. We call it release party. It was well. It went well. The audience was good. We managed to play our set fairly well. We didn't have this amazing, blistering performance. But the next Friday, we're going to play in Athens, and that's going to be completely wild.
Yeah. Talking about that, as we already know, you are heading a tour in Maine to promote Aura Noir in Europe, and UK date in London, starting in Greece, Athens, May 4th, May 7th in London, May 9th in the Netherlands again, but this time in Utrecht, May 11th in France, Blozevet, and July 13th in Gevenet in Switzerland for the Forest Fest Open Air. How much are you looking forward to this, and what can the attending fans expect from your upcoming shows?
With this new album, we are going to play 4 or maybe 5 new songs, and it's going to be a different set than what people have become used to. We played the same set for quite a while, or almost the same set. Now it's good to have some new material in there, and it's material we really love playing, so it's going to be good. Apart from that, it's the same. It's somehow, you know, our formula works. It's our music works very well live on stage. So what you can expect is just some new songs, I guess.
What else do you have planned for the rest of the year in support of the band, a brand new album, Aura Noir?
We're gonna tour in Australia, New Zealand, and Singapore. We have a short tour of 5 gigs there. Of course, the Swiss festival, and then come December, we're gonna play a tour with Obliteration in Europe, and about 12 gigs, I think. And we're gonna do a tour bus and everything, so it's gonna be good.
Great. Any other big stages for the summers? Wacken or Summer Breeze or any others big festivals?
No, not really. Our album came a bit too late to join the summer festivals.
I guess I saw you guys play one of the festival I saw you, so I remember that was 2012 for Wacken, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Have you played late Brutal Assault? Brutal Assault this couple of years, but I can't remember seeing you.
Actually, we're going to play Brutal Assault this year. I forgot. We're going to play this year, August, in Czech.
Okay. That's a very great festival. Very cool.
That's a very cool one.
After nearly 25 years upholding and reinvigorating thrash metal grimace tradition for the delight of the international underground, in 2018, the ugliest band in the world unleashed their 6th full-length album on indie recordings, the semi-self-titled Aura Noir. With no overdubs or embellishment, the album underscores the band's potency as a power trio and reinforces their primacy among thrash primal phantom. I want to say thanks to our Norway based correspondents and indie recordings rep Jelena Mijatovic, who brought us this great chance to meet with you, Aggressor. And I want to hand you over the microphone of Metal Messiah Radio for you to invite all your friends, all your fans, to support the bands, to buy this great new masterpiece, Aura Noir, and to attend all the shows the band have coming up.
Oh, yeah, that would be a good thing if you buy it, our album. Of course, I don't expect you to buy it because people just stream these days, but it would be good if you came to see us live, and we're gonna deliver a ripping show for you.
Okay, before you leave, Aggression, any merchandises for the fans if they want to buy your merchandises?
We're gonna bring on tour whenever we play live. We try at least to have one shirt and a few CDs that you can buy, so yeah, buy them.
Once again, Aggressor, thank you very, very much. It's been a very great, great pleasure for me to have this great honor to talk to you. And we'll keep in touch. We're going to be heading to Europe this year again for festivals. Hope to see you guys live again. And in the meantime, all the best with this great new album, Aura Noir. And like I always say, bye-bye. Metal on.
Bye bye, guys. Hi, this is Aggressor of Aura Noir. I'd like to congratulate Metal Messiah Radio for its 10th anniversary.
Illuminated with air, born into the broken.